a troubled world, I pray the Lord to keep. Keep hatred from the mighty and the mighty from the small.
RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
In a big, big way, we do. Good morning. Welcome to a Tuesday. I don't even know where to begin today. So we'll do the regular. I'm Nicole Sandler, coming to you live at RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com. Hold on. I'm trying this SoFlo computer to make sure this is running. Looks like it isn't. Oh, no. Looks like this rebooted and, All right, we'll get SoFlo Radio going in a couple of minutes. TalkRadio1.com. Of course, our newest stream, our video stream at YouTube.com. As soon as this computer reboots, I will get SoFlo online. Where do we even begin? Wow. You know, yesterday morning, as I was taking Allison to school, hold on, I got to, I don't even know the password on this. Is that it? As I was taking Allison to school, I was hearing the reports that, again, it was going to be another day with tornadoes in certain parts of the country, Texas, Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And, so for the pre-show music yesterday, I played, I played a bunch of Stormy Monday kind of songs, weather songs. I played Stormy. I played Little Tornado by Amy Mann, Like the Weather, 10,000 Maniacs, Weather with You, Crowded House. You know, I was being clever. Stormy Weather by Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong to get the show started. And to finish things off, I played the Allman Brothers live at Fillmore East, rousing rendition of Stormy Monday. Little did I know just how prophetic that would be, because yesterday turned out to be just a horrific day. And I don't need to tell you now, because if you don't know what happened yesterday, then you've been under a rock, or perhaps you've been without power. But this huge tornado hit the town of Moore, Oklahoma, and when I say hit, I mean hit. It devastated this town. And we were running around. Yesterday was David's birthday. Hold on. Let's get this thing started. Start. How do we start? Try it this way, maybe. So yesterday was David's birthday. So I picked Allison up from school. We had, can I start it this way now? Hold on. Okay, hold on. Start all. Are we going? Okay, there we go. So SoFlo Radio should be online now. So yesterday afternoon, I pick Allison up from school, and I turn on the news in the car, and I start hearing reports of this elementary school in Moore, Oklahoma, that was just flattened, along with the entire town that surrounds it. And just the reports were devastating. Okay, now what's going on here? This computer is being weird. Hopefully it'll stay on. Are we still going? Streaming. Yes. Okay, we're good. And then I had to run in the store to get something for dinner, and Allison stayed in the car and was listening. For once, she didn't change the station to put on her music. She kept listening to the news, and when I came back out to the car, she said, "Mom, there was another big storm in the same place on May 3rd, 1999. That was her birthday. That was the day she was born, we think. No, that's the day we acknowledge as her birthday. And as the evening went on, the reports were more and more devastating. So while this is happening, and again, all the media outlets seem to, stop whatever else they were doing to cover, you know, this massive tornado, which by reports was anywhere between 1 and 2 miles wide. It covered a 20-mile or 10 to 20-mile long swath of land, wiping out everything in its path, and was on the ground. Was touching for a period of 40 minutes. Now, as somebody who has been through earthquakes and hurricanes, I think a tornado like this is probably the worst of the three. I mean, they're all horrific. But at least with a hurricane, you have advance warning and you can stock up and you can get the hell out of town, right? Because you know it's heading your way. You don't know if you're going to be hit directly, but you know it's heading your way. With an earthquake, at least it's over, you know, in the worst earthquake at all, it's over in, 20 seconds, although there are the aftershocks. But with this, you know what? They maybe had 15 minutes warning, and that just the sheer power of this thing. Oh my God! So I mean, there are so many stories as daybreak has happened in Oklahoma now, and I was glued to the TV this morning. Actually, I woke up in the middle of the night. I couldn't sleep. Long story. Maybe I'll save for another time. But I woke up at about 4 o'clock in the morning, came out in the living room, turned on the TV, and eventually fell back asleep, but, was watching some of the coverage. But I'll tell you, this morning, the one story that really got me is this one. And I'm only going to play the audio because it's a CBS video embed that I couldn't download. So I don't have the video to show you on any of the video feeds, but you don't even need the video here to hear what's going on. So a CBS reporter is interviewing a woman, an older woman. She had to have been, I would say, late 60s, early 70s. And around her is just her house in splinters, in pieces on the ground, right? And listen to this interview.
Right. So you hid under there?
Uh-huh.
And what was it like when this came through?
I was holding my dog. I was sitting on the stool holding my dog. This was the game plan all through the years, to go in that little bathroom. And the electric never went off because the electric went off in the bathroom about the same time I felt the stool come up out of the floor. And I rolled around a little bit, and when it stopped, I was right there. That Presto cooker is what I saw.
You were lying there in the rubble.
And I never lost consciousness. And I hollered for my little dog, and he didn't answer or didn't come. So I know he's in here somewhere. It was there and it was gone. Just no time. Then it was light, and I thought, well, I'm okay. And I had some stuff on top of me, and I started wiggling.
Are you able to comprehend yet what happened here?
I know exactly what happened here. Exactly.
What do you think of all this? This is your neighborhood. I can't imagine.
This is life in the big city.
Big city, more Oklahoma. And somebody notices the dog under the ruins behind her. Like a little, and you can see in the video, and I'll post a video on the blog today at RadioOrNot.com. You see this little furry head sort of under all the ruins, and they're pulling shit off of the dog, and the dog comes out seemingly uninjured.
Oh
my God.
Come on.
Get him.
Oh my God. And she can't pick up the dog. She can't pick
him
up.
Well, I thought God just answered one prayer to let me be okay. He answered both of them. Because this was my second prayer.
Unreal.
Poor little thing.
All right,
I'm so glad.
I can't carry him.
And she says she can't carry him. And the dog is walking along with her. I was flipping this morning back and forth between MSNBC and CNN. And I finally turned off the Morning Jerk show when Joe Scarborough kept equating the victims of this horrific tornado to the victims of the 9/11 bombing. Really? One has nothing to do with another except there was loss of life in both. Other than that, nothing. And it's like, okay, enough of this. And I turned on CNN, and I don't even know who the people were who were talking. This was audio in the car. And one thing that was said made sense. And one person there kept stressing the fact that, you know what, we're going to have a lot of good news today. In fact, we had heard that there was somewhere in the neighborhood of 100 people, a little over 100 people, pulled out of the rubble alive. So although they have changed the title of the mission now to recovery instead of rescue, there's still hope that some of those kids in that school that was devastated, it's completely gone, survived. And one report I heard this morning said that that all but four people were accounted for. So only four people were unaccounted for at this time. So that's good news. Maybe the numbers of people killed in this disaster will not be as horrific as we had heard. Now, you know, all morning the news outlets were still saying what they said last night, that the death toll was at 51. Although my news notes from Victoria Jones at the Talk Radio News Service this morning said 91. Either way, I mean, this town is just decimated. It's gone. It's unbelievable. And of course, we're hearing the calls to donate to the Red Cross. Now, yes, the Red Cross does some good work, but here's the problem. If you give money to the Red Cross, it goes into the general fund, so that money could go to anything. If you want to make sure the money goes to help these people who were just, you know, their lives were turned upside down last night, many lives lost yesterday. There is a group called Team Rubicon, and I learned about Team Rubicon, last night from a veteran friend of mine. And what Team Rubicon does is, let me see if I can't, do I not have that? I don't have that window open now. Let me bring it up, and I'll tell you exactly what they do. Team Rubicon, just as how it sounds, R-U-B-I-C-O-N. Team Rubicon, it's a disaster response veteran service organization. TeamRubiconUSA.org is their website. And this is a group of veterans who goes and responds to disasters. They went to, New York, New Jersey for Hurricane Sandy relief. And now they are already on their way to Oklahoma to help out here. And yesterday, here's what somebody wrote. This is the latest blog post there. We are launching Operation Starting Gun. It says, Team Rubicon Nation, this afternoon finds us devastated as we watch the events outside of Oklahoma City unfold. The tornadoes that ripped through the city of Moore earlier today have left a community devastated, searching desperately for loved ones and hopes. Team Rubicon can't pretend to replace what has been lost, but as you read this, we are in the midst of activating every resource at our disposal to help these people in their time of need. Moore, Oklahoma is a disaster zone of unimaginable chaos, but luckily chaos is what we do well. By tomorrow, that would be today, we will have initial assessment teams on the ground. Within days, we will have mobilized a full response to help the people affected by this devastating disaster. We need your help. Please consider supporting us in our response and keep the people of Moore, Oklahoma in your thoughts and prayers. If you're a volunteer within 250 miles of Moore, please register your availability in Org Action, and there's a link there, ASAP. Do not self-deploy, it says. And they say that a lot. Do not self-deploy in all caps. But where it says, please consider supporting us in our response, is a link to their fundraising page. I made a donation at 4:30 this morning. You can too. And I think, look, again, the Red Cross does good work. But if you want to immediately help these people in Moore, Oklahoma, that's a good way to start. TeamRubiconUSA.org. And again, I'll have links on my blog after the show today at RadioOrNot.com. Today on the show is sort of going to be a day of action because the people in Oklahoma are not the only ones who need our help. People who are in Texas today who look like they are going to be hit with a number of tornadoes. Yeah, and no global climate change. What are you kidding? And I do know that there are some people and meteorologists and such warning that this is not necessarily this storm, not necessarily a sign of climate change. What is a sign of climate change is the fact that we are going to have more storms, more events, more weather events of huge magnitude more often. And whether this one, look, I had somebody, I know Mike M. in the chat room said that there is a climatologist saying that this was not a strong case to relate to global warming. And actually an online, email list that I'm on, there's somebody else who cautioned us to not necessarily relate this one incident to climate change. Let me see if I can find it. Oh, okay. I'm just going to share this with you. It says, I'd only be hesitant to say too much about climate change here, if only because there are really long-term patterns that have to be considered with tornadoes. It's also worth noting that 2012 was, I believe, a record low year for tornadoes because of the drought. And so climate change may also lead to less tornadoes in the long run. Of course, climate change is also expected to create more extreme weather in general, so it is certainly possible that more EF4 and EF5 tornadoes are in the offing, even if the overall tornadic rate declines. Finally, one thing worth considering here is land use patterns and sprawl. With the level of sprawl we see in the Sun Belt, the chances of tornadoes hitting populated areas goes much higher. There's a good 50-mile stretch in the Dallas-Fort Worth metroplex that is heavily populated along I-35, for instance. And guess what? That's the stretch that today it looks like it's going to be hit by some tornadoes, tornadic activity, as they say. And meanwhile, on a related note, I retweeted something this morning without actually reading the article. I don't do that very often, but it was from Howie Klein. And Howie Klein wrote a piece up at downwithtyranny.com that says, Keystone XL Pipeline gets its big House vote tomorrow. And he writes, John Barrow of Georgia, one of the shadiest and most cowardly fake Dems in the House, is a co-chair of the reactionary Blue Dems and member of the corrupt, corporately owned New Dems. And it goes on and on. And he tweeted out, this week, the House will consider a bipartisan bill I introed with somebody else to approve Keystone Pipeline. Tomorrow, they say, in the House. In all likelihood, it'll pass the House tomorrow. be hailed as a bipartisan bill, and then it'll go over to the Senate, where it very well could pass as well, since so many Democrats take massive bribes from big oil. And I'll tell you what, if this goes through, then, you know, what we saw in Oklahoma yesterday, just the beginning. That's just the beginning. Because whether or not there's a, you know, this tornado can be directly related to, you know, climate change, this type of intense weather, these weather events are going to be more frequent and more intense. Get used to it, because this will be the rule rather than the exception going forward. All right. Now, I did say that we are going to, today is going to be sort of a day of action. The people in Oklahoma aren't the only ones who need our help. You know, over the last couple of weeks, we have covered on this show a number of work actions, strikes, starting with the fast food worker strike in New York that then spread to Chicago, that then spread to St. Louis, that then spread to Detroit. Well, today, another group of low-wage workers is going to stage an historic strike. In Washington, D.C., it's actually already happening. hundreds of low-wage workers employed under federal contracts, concessions, and leases are on strike at the Ronald Reagan and Old Post Office buildings, the Smithsonian Museum, and Union Station. This is huge, and I'm waiting. Am I supposed to call them? Hold on. No, I'm waiting for a call from one of the campaign organizers of Good Jobs Nation. A guy named, where's his name? Travis Dupree should be calling us any minute now to tell us about this. But let me pull up. There's a piece at The Nation this morning written by Josh Idelson, who I tried to get on, but of course he is in a meeting as we speak. But what Josh wrote is, here, let me read part of it until we hear from our guest, Travis Dupree. Starting at 7:30 this morning, hundreds of non-union workers with tax-supported jobs plan to go on strike in the nation's capital. Organizers expect the one-day walkout to include workers employed at the Smithsonian Museums, the Old Post Office and Ronald Reagan buildings, and Union Station, where tourists, lobbyists, and members of Congress arrive by Amtrak to Washington, D.C. The strikers are part of a recently unveiled organization, Good Jobs Nation. By the way, their website is goodjobsnation.org, and you can read more about it. And hold on, I'll share you from the website in a moment. Good Jobs Nation, backed by labor and community groups, they are demanding that President Obama take action to improve wages and working conditions for workers employed under federal contracts. If you go to goodjobsnation.org, you'll see a picture of a woman. You know, she's probably about my age, but she looks a bit more weathered and worn. Not saying I look great, but, you know, just saying. Oh, she looks Native American, but again, who knows? And next to her picture, it says, "Dear Mr. President, I'm a janitor for a cleaning contractor at Union Station, which is owned by the U.S. government. After two decades of service, I only make $8.75. That's $8.75 an hour. On such a small salary, my husband and I can't make the mortgage. We had to rent our bedrooms to strangers to keep a roof over our heads. Mr. President, I've never asked for a handout, but I'm asking you to be a good landlord." And it's signed, Natividad Lucilia Ramirez. I don't know if she's Native American or not. Then it goes down and there's information here. Who is the largest low-wage job creator? 600,000 low-wage jobs are created by McDonald's. 900,000 low-wage jobs are created by Walmart. And then it shows the U.S., the seal of the federal government. Click here to find out the total number of workers employed by the U.S. government with low-wage jobs. Over 2 million. Over 2 million low-wage jobs are created by the U.S. government. It says, with the stroke of a pen, the president can lift millions out of poverty. Hold on. I'm playing producer as well as host here. Let me see if there's any word on where our guest is, because I've not heard from him. Let me see if I can find her. Oh, here. Hold on. I'm still waiting, so let me Still waiting on Travis to call. Whoops. Okay. Sorry. You know, the necessary evils of not having a producer. All right. Let me just put it in the subject line. No call yet. Okay. All right. So now back to, again, this strike, which has hit Washington, D.C., you know, has happened. It has started this morning. About us, about the Good Jobs Nation. We are workers who do important jobs for our nation. We pick and process food for school children, greet visitors at our national parks, clean and safeguard government buildings, sew the uniforms for our troops, haul cargo to military bases, and even answer calls when people have questions about government benefits like Social Security. We are the workers who are employed by private companies through federal contracts, concessions, and leases. Yet, while our employers reap billions of dollars in profits from taxpayers every year, we are paid such low wages that we are unable to afford basic needs such as food, clothing, and even rent. We are uniting to call on the federal government to stop being America's leading poverty job creator by paying us living wages and benefits. We are fighting to make America a good jobs nation once again. And then there's a whole bunch of information on this website, again, goodjobsnation.org. But there's a link here, letters to the president. And let me share some of these with you because it's really stunning. Again, federal workers can't strike. But these are workers employed by private companies who hold federal contracts, leases, etc. And they certainly can, you know, strike. And this is the first time they are. And they all wrote letters to the president. Here's one. Dear Mr. President, rain or shine, I make sure the National Zoo in Washington, D.C. is open to the American public. I feel like what I do is important, but I'm struggling to make ends meet on $8.50 an hour. I'm 60 years old, and I can't afford to live on my own, let alone retire. Mr. President, we need you to make sure the companies that you hire to do work for the American people do the right thing by us. Signed, Joanne Keenan. here's another one. Again, and these were all written in the last couple of weeks. Dear Mr. President, I'm one of your biggest supporters, but I want you to know that I can't survive on $9.65 an hour, which is what I make cleaning office space rented by the Department of Justice. I must live with my cousin because I can't live on my own, and I use food stamps to eat. I can't even buy gifts for my 4-year-old grandchild. Mr. President, please use your power to help the people. Signed, Katina Washington. You see, here's the problem. Again, these for-profit entities get these federal contracts, but then they hire people at, you know, at poverty wages, and therefore they have to go on assistance to make ends meet. These people get food stamps. You and I are subsidizing them. Not only are we paying these federal, these companies, private industry that the federal government contracts, we're paying them, in many cases, big dollars, and then we have to subsidize their employees because they don't earn a living wage. Here's back to Josh Idelson's piece in The Nation. Quote, the truth is, I'm ready. I'm not scared. Janitor Vilma Martinez told The Nation in Spanish last night. Fear fades away, especially in the face of the unfair treatment we get here. Martinez, who's worked at Union Station for the past 19 years, said that the federal contractor, ICC Cleaning, pays her $8.75 an hour. $8.75 an hour after 19 years. She said she's supposed to get regular checkups for a serious heart condition, but only sees a doctor when she goes back to El Salvador because she's uninsured. Today's strike follows the release last week of a report from the progressive think tank Demos, estimating that at least 1,992,000 workers receive $12 per hour or less while doing jobs backed by public funds. Through federal contracts and other funding, authors Amy Traub and Robert Hilton Smith wrote, our tax dollars are fueling the low-wage economy and exacerbating inequality. This is just flat-out wrong. This is heinous. And once again, we have, you know, this is our new normal, isn't it? Traub and Hilton Smith's tally includes jobs funded or supported through direct federal contracts, 560,000 jobs, Medicare or federal Medicaid spending, 1,184,000 jobs, Small Business Administration loans, federal child health insurance program, the SCHIP, right, or the CHIP, spending, federal infrastructure funds, or public building service property leases. Quote, this is more than the number of low-wage workers at Walmart and McDonald's combined, writes Traub and Hilton Smith. At the other end of the pay scale, and here's where it gets even more disgusting, at the other end of the pay scale, they note, the executives who employ these workers can legally be reimbursed by taxpayers for a total compensation of up to $763,029 per year. The Office of Management and Budget did not respond to a request for comment on the study late Monday afternoon. I'm sick. I'm disgusted by this. Truly disgusted by this. It continues. Good Jobs Nation is backed by organizations including the Community Organizing Group, Our DC, the Clergy Group, Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference, and the Labor Federation, Change to Win. As the nation has reported, Change to Win affiliates have also provided support for recent strikes by non-union workers employed in Walmart stores, in subcontracted Walmart warehouses, on subcontracted cleaning crews in Twin Cities Target stores, and in fast food restaurants in five cities. So today, there's a lot going on in D.C., and if you are near D.C., you might want to go and back these people. Strikers will converge for rallies at, I'm going to read to you what I got from the press release. The National Air and Space Museum at 10 o'clock this morning. That already happened. Also at the National Museum of American History started at 10. At 11:30, they will gather at Union Station. At 12:30, they will have a rally at Union Station. And at 4:30 this afternoon, a big demonstration at Union Station. At that demonstration at Union Station, they'll have some members of Congress will join them. Keith Ellison, Raul Grijalva, Steny Hoyer, that's a shocker, and Eleanor Holmes Norton of D.C. They'll hold an ad hoc hearing to investigate the federal government's role in promoting low-wage jobs. Excuse me, that hearing's going to be at 3 o'clock this afternoon in the Cannon Office Building, room 340. On a day like this, boy, do I wish I could be in Washington, D.C. All right. I do not know where our guest is. I'm sure things are pretty crazy on the streets right now. So I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll take a break. And once again, I'll post all this information on my blog at radioornot.com. And we'll talk about another place where we need help today. By we, I mean the American people. I mean those of us who are not in the top 1 or 2%. I mean those of us who are, you know, being fucked and not in a good way. Ah, and here's our guest, I think. Hello?
Hello?
Hi, is this Travis?
Yes, it is.
Ah, hey, Travis. Travis Dupree, you're a campaign organizer at Good Jobs Nation, or where, who are you with?
I'm with Our DC.
You're with Our DC. All right, great.
Yeah.
We're live on the air, and Travis, I just filled our listeners in on what is happening in DC today, and this is a big deal. This is unprecedented, isn't it?
Oh, this is incredible, and it's a very big deal. I personally like to say, like, I'm so proud of these workers that have to take a stand and go nose to nose with their employers, as in the federal government contractors. To demand a living wage and better working standards. What they're asking is for our president to sign an executive order to give them just that. They want to be able to feed their families, not work more than 60 hours a week, not have to sleep on folks' couches working a full-time job, not have to make a decision whether they're going to fill their refrigerator or fill a prescription. We want to acknowledge that there's a difference between living and surviving, and these hard workers that work in some of the most lucrative buildings in the country are forced to just survive, and we know that we can do better.
You know, I'm so glad that this is happening today. I hate that these people are being forced to work like this. But I read some of the stories from the website this morning, and some people, you know, working in a job for 19 years and making $8.75 an hour, it's despicable. And the fact is, that these people are paid via tax dollars, because the companies that hire them, though they're private companies, they're paid by government contracts, by taxpayer dollars. And then these companies turn around and hire people at wages that nobody can live on. And it's inhumane and it's disgusting. And I didn't realize this was going on until today.
I mean, it's funny. I didn't know until recently as well. Fortunately, a lot of members of RDC work for federal government contractors, and they said enough is enough. So they came to us and asked what we could do to help. We found out there were other workers all around the city, all around the country that are dealing with this. And the fact that these hardworking people are literally serving or providing services to thousands of tourists in some of the most lucrative buildings in America, and these contractors, CEOs are making millions on top of millions and refuse to take a little bit less in salary,
yep,
a little bit less in bonus, and
yep,
make sure the people that are standing these companies up make a decent living.
Absolutely. And it's only fair. You know, when I read that some of the CEOs are making upwards of $750,000 a year while the workers are being paid pennies. It's really disgusting, and we need some pay equity in this nation. This is just despicable. Now, the way that these workers can strike as they are today is because they're not technically federal employees. They work for private corporations that have contracts for or hold leases from the federal government, and so because a federal employee can't legally strike, right?
Correct.
Okay, so this is all legal. So what's the response been so far today?
Well, from the community, once again, we have hundreds of community members out here today, so they're very fired up, and they're proud of these workers. And we want to make sure everyone understands that tomorrow or later today, when these workers attempt to go back to their jobs, after speaking out, that once again, we'll be right next to them to ensure that no one is retaliated against. And if we have to go back every day, we will, until every single person has a job and they're allowed to have those discussions and work with their coworkers about what they need to do to get a living wage.
Great. Now, I also see that you do have some support from some in Congress. You got Keith Ellison and Raul Grijalva, who are the co-chairs of the Progressive Caucus. You have Steny Hoyer, which to me, that's the surprise, because Steny Hoyer hasn't been a great friend to progressives, but good that he's there. And Eleanor Holmes Norton, they're holding this ad hoc hearing to investigate the federal government's role in promoting low-wage jobs. That's terrific. Is this going to have any legs?
Well, one thing, we think this is just the first step to get this attention around this, but we need a lot more of our congressional leaders to step up.
Absolutely.
Those that are on board, we really appreciate, but they need to continue talking to their, I don't want to say cohorts, but the people that they're working with every day and have access to that, mm-hmm, we can't get access to maybe bring some of the real faces. Like, you know, we're not numbers on a spreadsheet. You know, I sit with members every single day that are sitting on their sofas trying to figure out if they're going to fill the refrigerator or fill a prescription. And it breaks our heart. So once again, you know, we do have some leadership that's stepping up, and we implore every single person in each Congress to be heard and let them know these workers deserve better.
Yeah, you know, I'm following some of the comments on Twitter under hashtag 1U, also hashtag Good Jobs Nation. And somebody just tweeted, wow, protesters sitting in around the Greensboro Woolworths counter at American History Museum. Another one, the final stage of materialism, absolving a company of misdeeds because they make pretty stuff. Okay, that's interesting. I don't know. Together we stand, divided we fall, striking workers outside the Museum of American History in a picture. This is great. About how many people are on strike today?
I don't have the number. I've seen, 'cause we're at different locations.
Right.
I'll say if it was just one person, we would stand with him or her. But
absolutely,
the fact that there's numerous people out here, and the fact that the community right here in D.C. has stepped up and supporting these workers, it's just amazing. Like, I've never seen anything like it before. The energy is incredible, and they're ready to go all day, all week if we have to. So, once again, this is just the tip of the iceberg. So we want to make sure that everyone understands that this won't be a one-shot deal. Like, we will not stop and so these workers are treated fairly.
Great. So thank you for doing this. Now let's get the word out, because again, you didn't know, I didn't know that these workers who are employed by companies who are benefiting from contracts awarded with and paid with taxpayer dollars are this is promoting a low wage world, and we've got to pay people a living wage. That's just plain and simple.
Absolutely, and it helps the economy. Like,
of course,
these people would love to be able to go out to dinner and take their family to the dinner, to go buy their kids new clothes, to be able to buy better food at the grocery store. But they're forced to barely survive, and you know this country wasn't built on that. So we once again we're calling the president to sign this executive order and move this thing forward. And I just can't imagine what good things can happen from that signing.
Oh, absolutely. You know, in just a moment, I'm going to talk about the fact that, we just said a lot of these workers have to have government subsidy, taxpayer subsidies, for instance, housing assistance or food stamps, right, in order to live on the measly hourly wages they're paid. Well, today or this week, Congress is going to try to put through $20 billion cuts in the SNAP program. That's the food stamp program. So, you know, our people are getting screwed on both sides. So, Travis Dupree, I'm going to let you go and get back to work, and thank you again. And we're going to move on and talk to somebody about, you know, stopping Congress from cutting SNAP. Travis, thanks.
Thank you so much for getting the word out.
Thank you. I appreciate your work. Bye-bye.
Sure, bye-bye.
Power to the people. All right. So yes. So Congress now is attempting. I guess is going to vote. We're going to get all the details from Kim Doyle Willie. I met Kim a few years ago when I went on my sort of quest to help the 99ers, the people who are fighting for, you know, long-term unemployed, whose unemployment benefits have been decimated. And that's when I first met Kim. And Kim Doyle Willie joins us now. And Kim, you've been working on, fighting back, working on a project called Feed the U.S., the website feedtheus.com. And Kim contacted me yesterday and said, any chance I could come on your show to talk about the $20 billion in cuts to SNAP, that's the food stamp program, that Congress is trying to push through this week? Really? What is going on?
It's just ridiculous. Yesterday, the Senate voted to cut $2.4 billion from SNAP, which feeds so many people, like your guest was just saying, are working poor.
Yeah.
I think I'm looking really quick, but I think that it's 47% of the people that use SNAP are working poor. We do know that 47% of SNAP recipients are children. 8% are seniors, 20% are households with disabilities. We know that almost 1.5 million veterans and military families are using SNAP. So this is a huge cut to be taken.
You know, when we talk about the working poor, the thing that's different from, we've known that our taxpayer dollars through SNAP and other assistance programs subsidizes companies like Walmart and McDonald's and the other companies that we've been talking about, the other big players here. But I had no idea that we were subsidizing companies with federal contracts. So you know, people indirectly working for the federal government were also subsidizing their employers that are big corporations.
Well,
it's disgusting.
In these farm bills, they're also doing big giveaways. They're subsidizing corn and soy for ethanol production, allowing Monsanto to infect the world with GMOs this process.
Oh my God!
It's
and
a
by
really
the
backwards farm bills we've got.
Oh, really? Is and by the way, we're not going to get to Monsanto today, but hopefully tomorrow or Thursday. Apparently on Saturday there is a big march against Monsanto everywhere, May 25th. So that's coming up too. You know, today is sort of a convergence of people needing help, from Oklahoma, obviously, to these poor low-wage workers, not only in D.C., but who we first learned about today, to the low-wage workers, you know, working at Walmart or at fast food, and now who are in danger of losing their food stamps because of these cuts. So the Senate voted on a $2.5 billion cut yesterday, but the House this week is going to try to cut $20 billion?
$20 billion. Yeah, it's 2.4 they did yesterday in the Senate, but it's, $20 billion. And that means 3 million people will get kicked off of food stamps. That means it's something like 246,000 children will lose their school lunches.
I mean,
this is ridiculous to be doing this when people need a hand up. We also know, like Moody's, Mark Zandi, did a great comparison chart. I actually have a blog in Huffington Post, and you can see the different links to what I'm talking about. But Mark Zandi did a comparison of stimulus-type things. It was found that SNAP is the number one most effective way, and he even quoted in his quote with FRAC and Feeding America that that they should actually be expanding the food stamp program, because it gives a $1.73 stimulus effect. In that same chart, he shows that extending the Bush tax cuts only gave a 29-cent stimulus effect.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, because, you know, the rich don't even realize, we got more money in our, you know, paycheck or whatever this month. They just squirrel it away. Those of us who are living paycheck to paycheck or, you know, month to month, we spend the money that we get on things that we need.
And really, we have a 13.2% U6 rate, the real unemployment rate of under and unemployed and people who have stopped looking for work. But really, that's not even an accurate number, in my opinion.
Right.
But, you know, when you've got that many long-term unemployed, some people have been unemployed since 2008 because they're facing age, length of unemployment, and credit discrimination. So those people really need the food stamps, and it's estimated that 65% of people who are eligible for food stamps have not applied. And we also know that the food pantries I visit right now, they don't even know. It's just now. They're just now getting the memos of how their programs are going to be hit.
Right. And you know what?
I do know that 70 seniors in Parachute, Colorado, where the oil spill is right now, lost their Meals on Wheels. It was delivered from Rifle, which is 25 miles away. They lost $37,000 of their $47,000 transportation budget.
Oh, my God.
On a month's notice. I mean, these are real people.
You know, Kim,
and we've got kids going out of school right now, so they're losing many of those kids are losing their only meal in a day, their school
They're only
lunch.
Not meal of the day. You know, it's disgusting. And the other part is I looked into at one point food stamps, like how to get food stamps, because I was unemployed. I had exhausted all the money I had, except for I still had money in a retirement account. And that's, you know, you learn you don't touch that. And if you have a dime in the bank, if you have any assets at all, you are not eligible. So this is affecting the people who have nothing. I mean, what are they supposed
Absolutely.
To do? Starve to death? I understand there are people who feel that way. You know, are there no workhouses? Are there no, you know, Scrooges live?
Well, Andy's cuts take $90 a month, an estimated average of $90 a month per person out of those checks.
Oh, my God.
That's a lot of money. The average person lives on $224 a day is what your allotment is for average for SNAP across the country. Can you feed your each person on $224 a day? That's why
disgusting.
It's really important. People have got to call their Congress representatives and demand that they remove those SNAP cuts and that they not subsidize those big ag farmers that are growing soybeans and corn. I mean, we need real food. I encourage people to get into local food movements. The big thing, Nicole, I'm working on right now that you may not know about is I started Plant a Rota End Hunger, and I've been distributing packets of donated organic non-GMO urban vegetable seeds to gardeners in 4 counties now.
Wow.
We're in. And it's ended up in the process that we've had plots of land donated to us. So I combined with sustainability students from my local college, and we're putting together teams of volunteers that will help in those gardens, that will pick up and deliver the produce they'll pick it up from the gardeners and deliver it to seniors and shut-ins and children without school lunches this summer. And we've also got teams of gleaners who are gleaning the fruit trees. So if any of your listeners can start checking into what's going on, your neighbors are getting hungry. If you Google Feeding America and then map the meal gap map, okay, you'll find a map of every county in America. It's got all the hunger and child hunger statistics. It tells you how much a meal costs in your county and all kinds of really cool stuff. It's a very interactive map. And I really encourage you to find out what's going on, because really, your next-door neighbor is going hungry. They can look normal. You know, we're all dressed like we are in America. We don't look like those pictures we see in Biafra. So it doesn't dawn on people that really your people are hungry.
Well, you know what? Our epidemic of obesity has a lot to do with food insecurity, because in many cases, it's a lot cheaper to feed a family at McDonald's. You order from the dollar menu, and, you know, you can feed a family a lot cheaper that way than you can by buying them good, healthy foods. And it should be the opposite. It should be the opposite, and it isn't, and it's disgusting. So you see people who are grossly overweight, it's because they can't afford healthy foods.
Are you there?
Yeah, Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, I mean, I think it's counterintuitive, but that's the problem, right? I mean, the obesity epidemic can be traced back to food insecurity.
Absolutely, malnutrition and obesity are two sides of the same hunger coin. And if we think that cutting $20 billion is smart now, we're already not meeting the health needs of people. So many people still can't get insured, simply because they don't have the job, so they can't take advantage of the Affordable Care Act. I just saw a CDC report yesterday that says that 20% of American children have mental health disorders. How do we think sending kids to school hungry doesn't affect our children? You know, if that child isn't eating, they're sleepy, they're depressed, they will act out in class. All of these things are proven. That affects your child's learning in the classroom. Having hunger, a base need of people everywhere in the world, not met by Americans, is immoral. And we really need to step up and realize our neighbors are going hungry, and it's upon us. It's our onus to take care of our fellow man.
It is. Kim Doyle Willey is with us. She's an activist. She's you can find her at feedtheus.com. There's a great piece in Huffington Post that Kim wrote about these proposed cuts to SNAP that we have got to we need to call our representatives and say, don't you dare. You know what's really, I mean, this whole thing is so sad and so sickening, is that the United States is the wealthiest nation on the planet. We have more money than those big oil-rich nations, Saudi Arabia and, you know, Dubai and anyone you can name. There's more money here, yet we can't keep our children fed?
Right. I posted a thing on my Facebook the other day about, we have $500 billion in tax evasion per year. That's five times what it takes to feed 50 million people.
That's disgusting. Well, you know, and now the big story this morning is of Apple. So you've got Apple, you know, evading taxes by playing international games and offshore accounts and saying they don't, you know, they're not based anywhere. Pay your fucking fair share of taxes. That's the scandal at the IRS, is that these big corporations are not paying their taxes.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, I couldn't agree with you more.
We have, what is it, 1 in 5 children going to sleep hungry in the United States of America?
One in six. And see, 2 years ago, they keep hitting the food stamp program. 2 years ago, they've done cuts through in all the budget discussions. They've cut SNAP. 2 years ago, they cut SNAP by $4.2 billion to in part pay for the Child Nutrition Act, which is helping Michelle Obama's Get Let's Move program.
Yep.
And getting healthy foods into schools. So that's like, if you're taking $4.2 billion out of SNAP to pay for the school lunch program, that's like robbing Peter of his dinner to pay for his son Paul's school lunch.
Yeah. Exactly.
They just keep doing this stuff. And it's on the backs of the people who can least afford it. We have these programs in place because people experience this in history. We have to lift people up. A rising tide lifts all boats.
You're very true. And that's why we need to pay our workers a living wage. And
yeah.
We need to make sure that, I mean, people can live with dignity. They're working. These are not freeloaders. These are not people who are looking for a handout. These are people who are working hard, manual labor work, who are being paid pennies on the dollar while the CEOs of the companies that, you know, employ them are sitting on their fat asses just, you know, stowing away the bucks. It's not fair. And, you know, I was telling this story the other day. I've been pulling stuff out of storage because I'm throwing away money every month that I don't have to throw away. And so I found a guy on Craigslist to help me move some of the heavy items to try to sell and to whatever. Turns out he's a Ron Paul guy. And, you know, a box of books broke open. And there was Obama's Audacity of Hope. And he's like, ew, I'm not going to touch that. I'm like, what's the matter? Are you afraid you're going to get Obama on you? And he's like, oh, he's a socialist. And I said, you know what? First of all, he's not. I wish he was, because a little socialism would do us well, you know, would help people. You know, and here's a guy who is, you know, doing hard manual labor for $15 an hour, who drives an old beat up pickup truck, who doesn't have two dimes to rub together. And, you know, he's using bad words to vilify, you know, our side, who wants to make sure everyone, you know, goes to sleep fed, who has a roof over their heads.
I would have been pointing out to him that socialist has the Dow at over 15,000 and reduced the deficit to 2008 levels, despite constant blocking.
Yeah, he's a really shitty socialist, right?
In just that short of time, it's the fastest deficit reduction in history.
Yeah, I mean, really shitty socialist. I wish he was a better socialist and not worry so much about the big corporations and their bottom lines and care more about the poor, struggling average American. But, you know, in the next hour after the news, we've got two other big issues we're dealing with. And one is, you know, we keep hearing about how the housing market's coming back. Did you know that? The housing market's coming back. Home prices are rising. Now, you know, fewer homes are being foreclosed on, except for all those people who are still being foreclosed on, who are losing their homes, who the big banksters are not helping, and they're not, you know, their gift of a settlement that they got from the government is not helping these people. And a bunch of them yesterday took their grievances to the DOJ. Did you hear about this?
No.
The Home Defenders League and a lot of people, for instance, in the next hour, I'm going to speak with a woman named Vivian Richardson. She's a member of the Alliance of Californians for Community Empowerment. She was caught up in an unjust foreclosure in San Francisco back in 2009. She fought back. And it, starting in 2011, and was one of the few, she was able to keep her home from being stolen by the bank. But she's in D.C. helping fight for others who haven't stopped the banks from stealing their homes. But a few hundred people got in tents and basically occupied the DOJ yesterday. Now, of course, you would think that's the First Amendment right? Except the cops came out and arrested and even tased some of these nonviolent protesters. But we're also going to speak with somebody from the Home Defenders League, which is an organization of underwater homeowners, foreclosure fighters, and allies, who has helped to bring all these people to D.C. for this action yesterday that was supposed to keep going on. But the police this morning came by and said anybody who was still there was going to be arrested, and a number of people risked arrest to stay there. And again, we're carted off. But, you know, it's amazing. Today is a day of action. We are fighting on all these fronts. I'm also going to tell everybody about, I got an email this morning from an organization called One Miami. You know, I live in South Florida. And my local newspaper is called the South Florida Sun Sentinel, owned by the Tribune Group. Well, you know, the Tribune newspaper group, which also owns the Chicago Tribune, the LA Times, the Orlando Sentinel, and four or five other newspapers, is losing money, as are most newspapers these days. And it's for sale, and the Koch brothers are trying to buy it. So I got an email from this group, One Miami, today, and they are doing an action that the title of it, I just got to read this to you because it's so perfect. They're doing an action this afternoon called Sun Sentinel Doesn't Need a Coke Problem. So, I mean, on every front, we are on the defensive, and we're just trying to help one another and do the right thing. And it seems like, you know, I don't know, the big bad Republicans, and in some cases, you know, the Democrats are too busy taking their payoffs from big corporations in order to do the wrong thing.
Absolutely. We have the highest foreclosure rate in the whole state of Colorado, right where I live.
Oh, my God.
Our county has the worst foreclosure rate. It's unbelievable how backwards things have gotten, and I just feel like people have got to engage. They have got to start getting on the phone regularly and calling. Or use PopVox, P-O-P-V-O-X. You can register your vote and your opinion on that site on any bill that comes up in the Senate and the House. And I've learned from my own representatives that letters to the editors, they read those because editors pounce on things, and they watch PopVox because you'll see it's an interactive map that populates with the vote so you can see how many people agree with you or not.
Wow.
It lists organizations and their opposing and affirmative views. So we've got to use these tools and get to people. We've got to mobilize because it's not going to get done. The same few, you know, I've been an activist since high school, and it's always the same few people, and we're the busiest people doing it all. And we really need others to step up and just make calls and do your part. This stuff doesn't get changed without people doing their part.
I hear you. Kim Doyle Willie, again, I'm going to post all your information on my blog at radioornot.com. But the key takeaway here is call your congressman and tell them no cuts to SNAP. No cuts to SNAP, period. Thank you so much. And I will post your Huffington Post piece as well on the blog.
Great. Thanks, Kim. So much.
All right. We'll talk again soon. Anytime.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Bye. Yeah, I mean, look, it's like on every goddamn front, we are fighting and fighting and fighting. All right, time for the news.
I read the news today.
Oh, boy. All right, for this, we turn to the Talk Radio News Service. They're at talkradionews.com. Good morning. Who's on the line today?
Good morning. It's Ellen Ratner, and I'll tell you something really interesting. The press is very upset about the IRS investigations, et cetera. But why did they overlook the fact that the IRS has not looked into Apple?
Good question. Apple is a major corporate tax evader, and it's disgusting. You know, here, you know, we're supposed to be so proud of Apple, great American company, who is just shirking their corporate their social responsibility and their national responsibility.
As Victoria says, Apple is living in the cloud since they're not claiming that they live anywhere, and they didn't file income tax returns for 5 years.
That's disgusting. So that's even in the Steve Jobs era. You know, Apple has gone downhill since he died, and now we know it was, you know, they were fucked up under him, too. Excuse my language. I'm kind of pissed off today.
Well, you should be. Okay, now, it's very interesting on the situation with James Rosen from Fox.
Yeah, talk about this, because honestly, I didn't even know about this. So James Rosen, Fox reporter, who was investigated by the DOJ because he got somebody to give him classified information?
It was not classified information. Oh. That is what is so staggering about this.
Okay.
The best person to read on this, in my view, is Mark Carlin. He's the editor of Buzzsplash, a truth app.
Okay.
And what he said, and, you know, he's a lefty.
Yep.
He said, under Nixon, Reagan, or the Bushes, we wouldn't have tolerated Obama's surveillance state.
Nope.
Now, it's also interesting, my brother sent me this today, that virtually everything the government, this is from Freedom of the Press Foundation, virtually everything the government did to WikiLeaks is now being done to mainstream U.S. reporters.
Wow. Wow. You know, and I've heard from you guys that, look, as much as Alan, I know you're on my side of the aisle mostly as well, but that the Bush White House press office was a lot more accommodating to people than the Obama.
Oh, 100% more accommodating. Much nicer people to deal with. I mean, as much as I went on Fox all the time back then, complaining about President Bush, Mrs. Bush invited me to a private luncheon in her family quarters.
Wow.
With just 8 or 10 other reporters.
Wow. Yeah, but even the press people, you said, were easier to deal with?
The press people were easy to deal with. They were nice. They tried to help you out. It was really quite astounding.
And I know early on in the administration, you said somebody, you know, they asked you for names of good, you know, bloggers and things, and you, like, you know, you were kind enough to pass along my name. I never heard a word from them.
Of course not. Neither Tom Harbin rarely hears.
Wow. Unreal.
It's really quite astounding.
Unreal.
Now, also, this is hard to believe. I thought their job was to report. But and this is actually from the right wing, but it's correct. Chuck Todd from NBC said, well, what happened to the Republicans in 1998 and Bill Clinton, if all of Congress is focusing on hearings, the voters are going to punish them. I mean, that's his sort of excuse off this scandal.
Oh, my God. Okay.
It's quite astounding.
It is astounding. In the meantime, you know, while the Republicans in Congress are holding all these hearings over, really non-scandalous scandals, they're making mountains out of molehills in most of these cases, and for reasons we've discussed over the past couple of weeks. We're looking at a lot of real problems. First of all, you got the tornado in Oklahoma yesterday, and more.
Yes, the president just did make a statement.
Okay, but more coming today, possibly in Texas and in Oklahoma. You have Senator Inhofe saying, "Well, if there's going to be any relief," and this is the senator from Oklahoma saying
he wants to actually take that away,
yes,
from the budget. That's right.
There have to be offsets.
It's called offsets.
Right, exactly. And he and Coburn actually voted against Sandy relief, but now he's saying, well, you know what, yeah, we need money to rebuild, but it's got to be offset from other budget cuts. We have children going hungry in this nation. There's a strike in D.C. today of low-wage federal workers, actually workers of federal contractors, who are being paid measly salaries, you know, akin to fast food workers or Walmart workers, so taxpayers have to subsidize their food stamps. But we also have Congress voting to cut SNAP this week. I mean, it's like, enough already.
It's true. Enough already.
Enough already. I mean, when did we become such a despicable nation that we don't help the least among us, that we don't help the people who need help the most?
I don't know, and I will tell you that what is going on with the press is a mirror of that, because
yep.
They obviously don't want us to be investigating anything.
Anything. Right. And then, you know, people's First Amendment rights are on both on all fronts, you know, from the freedom of the press to freedom of assembly are being stamped on. I mean, we saw it with Occupy and a group yesterday, the Home Defenders League, and we're going to speak to some people from there in just a few minutes. They attempted to occupy the DOJ yesterday with tents and to call attention to the foreclosures are still happening and people are wrongfully being, you know, having their homes stolen, and yet not a single bankster, not a single person responsible for that mess has been prosecuted, let alone jailed. And what happened? These people were arrested and many of them tased.
But they go after the press.
Yeah, I know.
For doing our jobs.
Yeah, I hear you. I'm so sick of it all. I am just so sick of it all.
It's quite astounding. Okay. Just some other short little news here. Obviously, the Apple hearings are going on. Today should be, if not the last day, the second to last day on the immigration bill. So that is happening. And actually, there's going to be a banking hearing today. It's going on. And Jack Lew is going to be, this is the Financial Stability Oversight Council. And a lot of these questions are going to actually be pretty important, even though it's not, it's getting short shrift in the media.
Okay. Well, but more hearings. I mean, don't they have another vacation coming up? I mean, Memorial Day.
They do. It starts like Friday or Saturday, God. And goes through next week. It's Memorial Day vacation.
Oh my God! Meanwhile, today is the Senate immigration markup is continuing. Is this thing going to go
right.
through?
That's why I said it will probably go today. Probably clear tomorrow. Your friend Marco Rubio's. Is going to get a deal approved that would establish biometric exit system with the highest international travel. Yes, and it's going to track visa holders that are actually leaving the country as well as coming into the country.
Okay. Wow. How do you, Ellen, I got to ask, you know, you've been doing this stuff in D.C. for so long, and I'm sure right now Washington has been more dysfunctional than it is now at times.
Well, I think what's going on is them going after the press quite dysfunctional, and that is really not good.
I agree. Look, the whole with all this old scandal gate nonsense, I kept saying the only one that I see as a real scandal is the AP story. But even people I respect are going, that's nothing, you know, because it was a security risk. But the IRS story, nonsense. The IRS thing. The scandal at the IRS is one that the companies like Apple and GE and all these other corporate giants get away with paying zero in taxes,
right?
And that all these political groups are also enjoying tax-exempt status when the law says they have to be exclusively social welfare groups.
But even if you took the political groups that are getting tax-exempt status, with the exception of the big, big ones
right.
like Karl Rove,
right.
or even some of the
Bill Burtons. Bill Burtons, I got it.
Right.
Yep.
Yep. That amount compared to what Apple is not paying.
Oh God!
It's just staggering.
It is staggering. But you know what I'm saying is all that. Those are the scandals at the IRS, not the fact that they said, "Well, Tea Party, let's flag them." Well, because of course they're political operations.
Right.
And the thing is, the way they changed it, the law says that these organizations have to be exclusively social welfare, right? And for
right.
some reason, they're interpreting exclusively to mean primarily. Well, no. Exclusively is not primarily. Exclusively is exclusively.
No, I don't disagree. But again, if we're just talking about pure money.
I know. Oh, but money. Go after the big. Of course. Well, they should go after all of them. Because we're being told we, the wealthiest nation on the planet, can't afford to make sure that we, you know, kids don't go to sleep hungry at night. That when a monster tornado decimates an entire town, that if they want disaster relief, that they're going to have to cut somewhere else. I'm sorry.
The other thing that's kind of interesting is that, and this is from Citizens for Tax Justice, that Apple, not only have they not paid taxes, but they have salted away $102 billion with a B dollars. So if they were to pay tax on that, it would be $35 billion if that money went back to the
right, United. Right. Well, good. They should. They can afford it. You know, the other thing about Apple, look, I like Apple products, but they should be half the price they are. You know, we are being screwed by every corporation and seemingly every government entity out there, and not in a good way. I mean, it's
right.
I'm sick of it already. I think we need a massive uprising in this country. And I guess people,
that's
you know,
probably not going to happen.
No, it's not going to happen. But what do you think about these federal contractor workers on strike in D.C. today?
I think that's good news. I think somebody has to bring attention to it. We'll see if the press does anything.
Yeah. You know, and unfortunately, you know, the DOJ, the Home Defenders League, and the people trying to occupy the DOJ yesterday got nothing because of obviously all the news shows did wall-to-wall Oklahoma coverage. I'm hoping that, you know, this will get some coverage today because I think this is pretty huge. And did you know that, you know, at least some members of Congress are getting on board at 3 o'clock this afternoon? There's going to be an ad hoc hearing on the federal government's role in promoting low-wage jobs with Keith Ellison, Raul Grijalva, Steny Hoyer, and Eleanor Holmes Martin.
Well, when Steny gets behind something, that's very important.
Yeah, I know. That's the one that shocked me, because this isn't usually his thing.
No.
I know. So 3 o'clock this afternoon in the Cannon House Office Building, room 340. Wish I could be there.
I do, too. I wish you were up here, and that would be great.
Me, too. All right. Ellen Ratner from the Talk Radio News Service. Find them at talkradionews.com. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. You know, usually on Tuesdays, Got a Laugh is here from thepoliticalcarnival.net. She, though, is actually in the Boston area today because one of her sons is graduating. Instead of fixing the picture, I got no sound. So anyway, Laffy will not be here today because one of her sons is graduating from Tufts University. So she's at she's there. But we're going to continue our theme of taking action. So look, we haven't taken a single break yet. So let's do that now. Let me grab some water. And of course, the day I'm losing my voice is the day that there's a lot of talking going on. But, you know, that's okay. So we'll take a break, come back. A few things I want to share with you. And then we'll speak with some of the people from the Home Defenders League, a striker or somebody who actually was fought back against the banksters who were trying to steal her home, and one of the organizers of the Home Defenders League, and find out what they're doing over there in D.C. today at the Department of Justice, and what went on yesterday, too. But lots of important stuff coming up before then, so stick around. I'm Nicole Sandler. It is radio or not.
Washington fiddles while his middle class burns to the ground. Hear about it today on Hightower Radio. Stock market soars, exulted a typical headline in early May when the Dow Jones average topped 15,000. But this index of Wall Street wealth gives a false picture of our nation's true economic health. Yes, the privileged few are doing extremely well, but the workaday many are struggling and falling further and further behind as the jobs market sinks steadily from mere recession down into depression. The monthly unemployment reports don't tell the depths of misery out here in the real world beyond the view of Wall Street and Washington elites. For example, President Obama hailed the news that unemployment dipped to 7.5% in April. Unstated, though, was the stark reality that this good news dip was not due to a jump in job offerings, but to a bad news labor market so weak and discouraging that Americans are dropping out of it or never entering it. More than a third of our working-age population is no longer even in the job market, and only 58.6% of us are employed. Put the opposite way, 41% of the potential workforce is not working, about 102 million people. One more statistic, and it's a chiller. More than one out of five American families report that last year, not a single family member had a job. Our people are trapped in a jobs crisis that's sucking the economic vitality out of our nation, but our leaders even refuse to acknowledge it. In fact, corporate chieftains deliberately exacerbate the crisis by hoarding trillions of dollars that ought to be rushed into job-creating expansions. And politicians add to the casualties by gleefully firing hundreds of thousands of teachers, firefighters, and other valuable public employees. This is Jim Hightower saying, America's middle class is burning to the ground, while Washington fiddles with nonsense and Wall Street feathers its own nest. It's disgraceful.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
All All righty then. All right. I'm Nicole Sandler. It is RadioOrNot.com. And in just a few minutes, we'll speak with some of the people who were occupying the DOJ yesterday from the Home Defenders League, fighting back against, the banksters getting away with stealing people's homes. It really is just, it's surreal. But before we get there, I want to share this with you. I mentioned I got an email earlier today from One Miami. And One Miami is a group here, as the name would imply, from Miami, who is fighting back. Let me just read to you. Today at 12 noon, South Florida residents will be meeting at the offices of the Sun Sentinel, local newspaper, and protesting. Communities are concerned about billionaire Koch brothers' potential influence on media outlets. Protests have erupted across the country, including Orlando, because the Orlando Sentinel is one of the newspapers, along with excuse me, the South Florida Sun Sentinel, the Chicago Tribune, the Los Angeles Times, that are part of the Tribune group that is up for sale, and the Koch brothers want to buy it. Well, here's a little primer, if you will, on why people in Miami and Orlando and Los Angeles and around the nation are up in arms about this and saying, hell no, Koch brothers cannot own our media. Here we go.
Hi, Nicole here with the other 98%, here to talk to you about the Tribune Company. What's the Tribune Company? So glad you asked. The Tribune Company is basically a media conglomerate which specializes in newspapers. Yeah, I know, newspapers, but a lot of people still get their news from them. And the Tribune Company owns a ton of really important ones like the Chicago Tribune, the LA Times, and the Baltimore Sun. Now, the reason I'm talking to you about them today is because the Tribune Company is for sale. It's for sale for the cool sum of $660 million. Now, that sounds like a huge amount of money to me and you, but to the billionaires who are trying to buy it, it's chump change. Let's look at the first bidder. Rupert Murdoch. Rupert Murdoch is the person who bought you Fox News and the entire tabloid press.
Hi, I'm Bill O'Reilly. Welcome back to Hannity. Today marks the 19th straight day.
Believe it or not, though, and I can't believe I'm saying this, he's actually the better option in this situation, because his competition is the Koch brothers. No, not that kind of Koch.
Say hello to my little friend!
People, come on, not that kind of Koch. Now, if you haven't heard of the Koch brothers, it's because they keep a pretty low profile. But they're basically the evil billionaire geniuses who've been poisoning our democracy for the better half of the last generation. Not only are they responsible for every corporate think tank you could possibly think of, as well as the climate denial movement, they also are the main instigators behind Citizens United and the Tea Party. Now, let's just let that sink in, just for a second. Needless to say, the amount of damage they could do with the Tribune Company is terrifying. So there you have it. On one side, the corporate misinformation machine behind Fox News. And on the other side, two billionaire brothers who could easily play the villains of the next Bond movie. Whoever wins, democracy and all of us are sure to lose. But it doesn't have to be that way. Not this time. This time we're gonna fight back. We're staging an intervention, and we need your help. Think of it as the opposite of a hostile corporate takeover. This is going to be a people's peaceful takeover of the Tribune Company. We're going to reinvent the way media looks and acts. We'll take the Tribune Company and turn it into a nonprofit, like the Green Bay Packers, that can truly be owned by the people who care about the integrity of their news. The Tribune Company is staffed by amazing journalists who have dedicated their lives to the responsibilities of the First Amendment. But corporate consolidation is killing their profession. It's time to say enough. Let's put the free back in free press. All we need to do is raise $660 million to outbid the big boys. It's not so much, it's just $22 a piece if 30 million Americans step up to the plate. But you know, a lot of you can give more than $22. Looking at you, Jay-Z, Beyonce, Oprah, your country needs you. If we pull this off, it'll be big. I'm talking history book big. So join us. And when your grandkids ask you if you were there when the tides turned and we took power back from the corporations, You could look at them squarely in the eye and say, I certainly was.
There. So, free the press by the tribune.org, I think, is the website on that. I will make sure and post that video as well. I mean, can you imagine if the Koch brothers owned 8 or 9 major newspapers? You know, I've mentioned this many times before. In Italy, you know how they got Berlusconi in power, don't you? Yeah, he owned the newspapers. And I understand, you know, newspapers are not profitable, but a lot of people still read them. If the Koch brothers are allowed to buy the newspapers, then we are truly, truly screwed. That's all. All right, so let's recap, shall we? Today is the day of action. Gotta Laugh is at her son's college graduation today. She'll be back next Tuesday with us. But there's so much need that I thought today would be the day we talk about all the shit going on. from our last guest, Kim Doyle Willie, talking about the proposed $20 billion in SNAP cuts by Congress this week. Call your congressman. We talked about the striking workers who are... don't directly work for the federal government, but they're employed by private corporations who benefit, who exist because of our tax dollars, who have government contracts or leases or concessions, and they pay their workers measly pennies on the dollar. I mean, $8.75 an hour for someone who's worked in this one place for 19 years? Disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. Go to goodjobsnation.org for more information on that. And if you're anywhere near D.C., at 12:30, there's going to be a big rally at Union Station. At 4:30, another demonstration at Union Station where a lot of these workers will be striking. And this ad hoc hearing at the Cannon office building, room 340, at 3 o'clock this afternoon. All right. What else did we talk about today? Oh, yeah. You know, the Sun Sentinel, there you go. Well, there's more, but, I do have another guest on the line and, hold on. I need to add this one. All right. I love it when people call in as they're supposed to. And first let's start with, Nathan. Nathan Henderson James, you there?
I am.
Okay. Nathan Henderson James is, he's a friend of mine, and Nathan runs the digital program for the Home Defenders League I've been telling you about. They're an organization of underwater homeowners, foreclosure fighters, and allies who I helped put together. Nathan, explain what started yesterday in D.C. there outside the DOJ.
Sure. So... I'm going to try to make this as short and sweet as possible, but the act, so bear with me, the action at the Department of Justice was part of a long history of folks fighting the effects of the Great Recession that was caused directly by the predatory lending and greed and recklessness of big Wall Street bankers. And the events that precipitated this particular reaction to that destruction of our economy was Eric Holder recently saying in a Senate hearing that the Department of Justice really did think that banks were too big to jail because if they tried to do anything to hold them accountability for the crimes they had committed that led directly to the Great Recession,
right,
then there might be some economic consequences throughout the world economy. And we think that is just ridiculous.
Yes.
Everybody is subject to the same laws. And so homeowners who have lost their homes or fought back and been struggling to keep their homes from being stolen by Wall Street banks went to the Department of Justice to demand that that policy end and that banks be held accountable. And, of course, what happened was that once again, instead of arresting bankers, they arrested homeowners who were just trying to get some justice.
Not only did they arrest the homeowners, they tased many of them who were exercising their First Amendment rights to peaceably assemble and protest. I'm just stunned. And so this was supposed to be an occupation. There were tents. In fact, I'm for those watching on the our Ustream feed, you'll see some pictures that are posted to the Home Defenders League Facebook page. Excuse me. And pictures of the tents there. So this was supposed to go on for a while. But once again, the powers that be there were so frightened by the show of protest that they called out the cops and arrested and tased peaceful protesters, yes?
Yeah, it was, you know, the visuals, if you were able to see it, especially at the peak of what was going on yesterday when there were 500 people there and 70 people, most of whom had lost their homes, some of whom had been able to save their homes by fighting back, had agreed to risk arrest in an effort to make sure that their grievances were heard by our government, right? This is the First Amendment, right? Peacefully petition for redress of grievances. And so there were 70 people who were willing to try to do what they could in order to get there, to the point of being willing to be arrested, and 22 of them have ended up being, I'm sorry, 27 of them have ended up being arrested. So if you look at the visuals, you know, there's 500 folks gathered around the Department of Justice all demanding that the real criminals be investigated and jailed, and what happens is, as folks are exercising that right, I want to emphasize that this was a nonviolent protest. No one put their hands on any cops. No one destroyed any property. No one was there to engage in any type of rough stuff. And in fact, no one did. Despite that, at least, I have confirmed, at least three people were tased in the process of being arrested, even though they were nonviolently and non-resisting the arrest, right? They were passively resisting,
wow,
which means they were just going limp, or they were lying down. They weren't trying to fight or anything.
I'm sorry. This is despicable. The Home Defenders League has been around for about a year, maybe a little more, yes?
Yeah, we officially launched at the end of May, the beginning of June in 2012.
Okay.
And so it's been almost exactly a year since we started doing this type of work, obviously building on the great work of many other organizations
sure.
that came before us, including folks at Occupy Homes. Certainly there was some inspiration from the whole Occupy movement.
Mm-hmm.
Groups like Acorn, which are no longer with us, did a lot of aggressive work on predatory lending before the Great Recession, and then after the Great Recession pioneered a lot of home defense work to keep people in their homes as banks were trying to steal them. So,
you know,
like we're building on all that type of work.
Nathan Henderson James, you say after the Great Recession, I would guess that there are many of us who don't feel it's over yet. Although we keep hearing, wow, the housing market has come back and the job numbers are up, and but there are a lot of people obviously still hurting and still having their homes stolen from them, as, you know, necessitated this action. And in fact, also on the line with us is Vivian Richardson. And Vivian, I think you and I spoke back probably a couple of years ago when you got caught up in an unjust foreclosure of your home that you were successfully able to fight off. So welcome back, and thank you for being here. And you live in San Francisco, but you went to D.C. to help fight for others who haven't been able to stop the banks from stealing their homes, yes?
Oh, hello.
Hi. Go ahead.
Hi. This is Vivian.
Hi, Vivian. Go ahead.
I'm trying to get to a spot to where I can, you know, have good reception and not much noise coming. Yes.
So, Vivian, tell us a bit about what happened to you. What's your story?
My story. Got caught up in the a foreclosure auction and to the point of almost eviction, and was able to get my house saved with allies or in a community organization such as ACE, the Alliance of Californians for Community Empowerment Unions and such. And it was quite a struggle, but we did it.
So what made you go to D.C. This week to take part in this occupation of the DOJ?
Well, although I've been able to win my home back, I there are so many that have not been as fortunate that are still struggling and fighting. And when I won my home back, I vowed that I would do any and everything that I could to help those, to be some kind of voice or a body, whatever I could do to make sure that, you know, this whole economy crash comes to an end.
Vivian, what were your thoughts when you heard Eric Holder say, well, we can't arrest any of these banksters because, it might hurt the economy?
But they already hurt the economy.
You're right.
That's my first thought.
No.
And, of course, if I were to commit the same type of crime, I would be in jail. No question asked. So, they're human just like I am, and they should go to jail as if I would go to jail.
Absolutely.
I just think it's totally unfair.
Now, the government cut some kind of deal with the banks that, they would have to pay so much money in damages to people who were wronged in these foreclosures. Vivian, did you get a check?
I did get a check.
You did?
I did receive a check from the Independent Foreclosure Review.
Yeah.
Yes, I did. However, the amount of money that I paid out in order to fight and prove that I was right in trying to keep my home, it was nothing compared to what I've already paid out.
I'm sure. I know it's hard to hear. There are people who lost their homes, whose homes were wrongfully taken from them, and they got $250 or $1,000. Like, that's supposed to make it better?
Exactly, and there are a lot of people that are not even cashing those checks because it's an insult.
Wow.
A complete insult.
Wow. That whole settlement, obviously the wronged homeowners had no say in the matter, and yet, this was decided for them. And I guess if you cash the check, you give up your rights to further fight, not that you have any rights along those lines anyway.
Right, and not only that, but, the house is gone. So, what do you, you still can fight, and there are still others that are out there fighting the fight, even after losing their homes and not cashing the checks. But, it still doesn't make it right.
No, it doesn't. Nathan, I want to go back to you and ask, so what's happening today? Is this action over because of the police action?
So the action isn't over. There's still, the people who are most committed to standing up to the Department of Justice and demanding that they stop arresting homeowners and start arresting Wall Street criminals are still around. A lot of the 500 folks who were there to support have gone home. Many of them were from out of state and wanted to make sure that the folks who were risking the most had support that was visible and vocal. So there's about 70 folks still around, there's a couple of different things that folks are willing to do and want to do. One is they continue to occupy the public space around the Department of Justice, complete with our signs and tents and banners and flags to make sure that as folks go by and go into the building, they know that we're there, and then they can see the types of things that we're demanding in the face of, frankly, indifference at the very highest level of the Department of Justice. So that's one aspect, and we plan to occupy that space for as long as we can today. And then today there's also a set of actions going on around the district from other folks who are similarly affected by the Great Recession. There's fast food workers and folks who are temporarily employed by government contractors who are going on strike, and we want to stand in solidarity.
We've been
with them.
Covering that this morning as well. It's pretty amazing. Some of the stories that I'm hearing are incredible, absolutely incredible. And it's time that you know, it seems like those of us who don't have the money to buy lobbyists are the ones paying the biggest price, are the ones being hit the hardest in the so-called shared sacrifice of crawling out of the Great Recession.
The shared shakedown.
Yeah.
The shared shakedown, that's what it is.
Well, that's what it is. And you know, it's, I'm sorry, the poor, you know, I also had someone on who was talking about the fact that Congress this week is going to vote on $20 billion in cuts to the SNAP program. Food stamps. I mean, when do they stop bilking the poor? When do they stop taking advantage of those of us who don't have the money for lobbyists to fight back?
Well, you know, I don't think they'll ever try to stop. It's up to us to stand up and say, this isn't the kind of America that we want it to be. We want to live in an America where we look out for one another and we stand in solidarity for one another and we help each other when things are tough. And certainly in a country of 300 plus million people, one of the best ways to make sure that we're standing in solidarity with each other and making sure everybody has a fair chance is to make sure things that support healthy families and strong families, like food stamps, access to affordable and accessible health care, quality and affordable housing, child care, and a range of other things, are best able to be distributed amongst the folks by the government, right? That's why we have food stamps. That's why we have, an agricultural program. That's why we have Medicare and Medicaid, some of the best programs the government has ever put together. And that's the type of America we want to live in. And we have to demand it. We have to fight for it. And we have to, like, stand up for it. And I think that what Vivian and other folks like her are doing are showing us the way forward. You know, this is what we
absolutely
need to do. And I think that's why we're standing in solidarity with our brothers and sisters in D.C. today.
Good. Well, it's a great start. And I understand that movements take a while. But it seems like our side is always playing defense when, because we're being constantly bombarded. You know, I look at the stories this morning out of Oklahoma, and especially that school in which, you know, I don't know, I've been on the air for almost 2 hours now, so I don't know if the numbers of school kids who were killed when that entire school collapsed have gone up yet, but regardless, too many. And we find out that that school in Oklahoma, in the town of Moore, which on May 3rd, 1999, also took a horrific direct hit from an even more powerful storm that maybe wasn't quite as big but had even stronger winds, this school did not have a storm shelter. And when the mayor was asked why on TV this morning, he said, expense. We're the wealthiest nation on the planet, yet we can't make sure our kids don't go to bed hungry at night, and people don't lose their homes to criminals, and kids don't die when a storm hits their school. I'm sort of dumbfounded at this point of, you know, and we've got all this money being hoarded by corporations like Apple and GE, and we're hearing there's a scandal at the IRS because Tea Party groups were targeted when there aren't supposed to be any political groups getting, you know, tax-exempt status, but no one's calling the fact that GE and Apple don't pay any taxes a scandal?
It's totally a scandal. I mean, Vivian, wouldn't you say that's a scandal? I would say,
that's a scandal, but I think the priorities of the media are screwed up. I'm sorry, I'm venting today because the whole show has been about all our needs, right? And we have a mutual friend who launched a fundraising thing for Team Rubicon to raise money to get this group of veterans who go to disaster sites and help. It's about helping one another, and you're doing such a great job of that. The Home Defenders League is doing really good work. So I mean, what happens to people? Vivian is one of the lucky ones there who was able to save her home. But what about those who weren't? And we heard so many horror stories about people who were illegally foreclosed on and lost everything. What happens to these people?
Vivian, you talk with a lot of folks when you're with ACE. She's a member of ACE, and ACE is a member of the Home Defenders League. How do those kind of conversations go with other folks who are in a similar situation but haven't been able to force their bank to do what's right?
Vivian, you still with us?
We might have lost Vivian. Let me see if it looks like she's
I'm
still
here.
Oh,
I'm
there.
Sorry.
She is. Okay.
I was on mute.
Sorry. So what happens to the people who have lost their homes? What happens to them?
Well, actually, I know in San Francisco we have a number of members, ACE members, and they actually are out fighting for others, for their community. They just kind of pick up the pieces that are, you know, trying to move on with their lives. They're not happy about it at all, but, you know, just doing the best that they can.
What do you
think? But I think, just to follow up on that, I think, you know, what Vivian is pointing out here is that there are a lot of people who have gone through this horrific, and in many cases, this is a very drawn-out process. Like, this is a multi-year process, which is high stress. It affects your health. It affects your outlook. It affects your, like, mental, yourself mentally. You know, and they go through the process, and some of them aren't able to get the banks. A lot of them are still at the mercy of the banks. But in some cases, especially folks who are hooked up with organizations or with support groups, they're able to, like, turn that experience around and start trying to help other people who are in a similar situation. And they find a lot of meaning and community by doing that. And the ones that I worry about the most are the folks who don't have that support system. They don't have an organization of folks that they can work with. They're really out there on their own. And I think we don't have good statistics on what happened to those folks, but we have a lot of anecdotal stories about, you know, people have to move far away from where they planted roots. Their children have to change schools. You know, some people go through temporary bouts of homelessness. They really have to remake their lives, in some cases from scratch, in ways that are, you know, when you talk about a life-altering event, this is a major life-altering event.
Absolutely. Does Eric Holder need to be fired?
You know, I don't have an opinion on that personally. What I want is for the Department of Justice to do the right thing. Do I think that having an AG who agreed with me on that would get us someplace? I think yes, but I'm not entirely convinced that whoever would replace Eric Holder would be any better than Eric Holder.
Right.
So I'm not sure that, like, calling for Eric Holder's resignation is the cure to this problem. I think the cure to the problem is to get the Department of Justice to actually enforce the laws on the books against the corporations that have clearly broken them. There's, like, so much research and reportage about this that it's almost completely inconceivable that we aren't already trying to do something about this.
It really is stunning. And you got to, like, say thank God for Elizabeth Warren, who seems to be the only one making a lot of noise about it.
I mean, there's a few, like, champions in Congress. Elizabeth Warren is certainly one of them. And she's very smart, and she's very good about the way that she chooses to publicize the issue here, and I think that's been tremendously useful for folks on the ground. You know, the average folks who are trying to struggle with keeping their homes from being stolen by multi-billion dollar corporations. There is one thing that's useful in terms of, like, comparison between our current situation and past. You know, we talk a lot about how, you know, it seems like corporations are definitely winning and that, you know, folks who have more power and influence have continued to use that power and influence to make sure that they get a bigger slice of the pie and everybody else gets a smaller slice of the pie. And you can see that by the way that we cut, you know, family supporting programs like SNAP and those other kinds of things. But it's also, and it's also true that in the past, in the Reagan administration, which many people look at as like a paragon of these conservative values where it's not so much about helping everybody, but so much about how much one person can get for themselves. In the Reagan administration, during the SNL crisis, which was really a scandal, the Department of Justice put 1,200 bankers in jail for causing that crisis. And here we are on a crisis of orders of magnitude worse. It almost breaks the entire world economy, and not one banker has even come, banker in charge of anything, has even come close to being prosecuted for it.
Right, no.
I feel like if the Reagan administration could do it, the Obama administration can do it.
You're right, and actually, it wasn't even, not only have they not been jailed, as Elizabeth Warren has pointed out, they haven't even been taken to trial.
That's right.
Right? I'm like, oh my God. I'm stunned. Absolutely stunned by it. Well, you guys are fighting the good fight, and again, there's so much. I mean, and I guess the good news, the silver lining here, is that we're not just taking it and rolling over and letting them walk all over us. There is, you know, the action that you guys, I mean, something just passed my Twitter feed about arrests this morning at the DOJ, including two people tased by the, you know, the people trying to, you know, call for justice and for some of these banksters to be finally arrested. Home Defenders League, your guys doing a great work, a great job. The federal non-union workers, you know, working for the government contractors and concession owners and leaseholders, finally striking for a living wage. I shared the fact that One Miami, down here where I live, One Miami is having an action today at the South Florida Sun Sentinel, because that's one of the papers owned by the Tribune Group that the Koch brothers want to buy, and saying, no, we don't need a Koch problem. We have on Saturday everywhere marches against Monsanto, and I'll get more into that tomorrow. But you know, we're not there. It seems like on all ends we're being bombarded, and yet we're saying hell no. You know what? We will help one another, and we will not let you do this to us. And I guess that's just what we have to keep doing, huh?
I think that's absolutely right. I mean, there's one thing that we say at the Home Defenders League, and really in many of these other groups as well, which is that when we fight, we win, right? That doesn't mean we win every single time, but mm-hmm. if we don't fight, we will never win. So when we fight, we win, and that's what Vivian did. She stood up, and she fought, and she hooked up with other people who were willing to fight, and she kept her home. And, you know, that's what's happening with fast food workers around the country. That's
right.
What's happening with Walmart workers around the country. That's what's happening with these federal contracted employees around the country. That's what's happening when people stand up to genetically modified organisms, and with the ability to patent food supplies. You know, people are standing up and saying, another world, we can live in a better America, and we can make that better America, and we can make that better America together, and that's what we're going to do.
Absolutely. Nathan Henderson James, again, with the Home Defenders League. Is that homedefendersleague.org?
It is.
Okay. And Vivian Richardson, who was one of the few who was able to save her home, she's a member of the Alliance of Californians for Community Empowerment, ACCE. And I'll post links to that both organizations on my blog today at RadioOrNot.com. Thank you both. Thanks for the work you're doing. And we'll keep on fighting, huh?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Oh, Bye. Boy. And we keep on fighting. All right. At the beginning of the show, I did mention that there are ways to help the people in Oklahoma, even as James Inhofe, senator from Oklahoma, today is saying, I think we need federal disaster aid, but those funds have to be offset. In other words, you may cut somewhere else so we can get the money to help my state. I don't think so. We've had enough cuts. We need to take care of our own. All right. A few more closing words. Let's just take a quick break. I'll be right back to wrap this baby up for it's only Tuesday. Oh, my God. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm John Kerr. Fox News' bogus claims and obsessive scandal mongering over the terrorist attack in Benghazi fell apart this week when the ABC exclusive that Fox held up as its Benghazi vindication was unraveled. But Fox continued to brag about their coverage. Roger Ailes' biographer Zev Chaffetz joined Steve Doocy on Fox and Friends to laud the network.
Fox News has been alone on Benghazi from the very beginning until now. And now, 8 months later, the other networks are seeming to climb on board.
Well, I think that Roger is a guy who
created Fox News so there would be a skeptical voice for government stories when they came from a certain direction. And this is Fox News at its best.
Martha McCallum and Bill O'Reilly also sung praises on America Live.
I mean, when you look at Fox's coverage of Benghazi, we've been establishing the facts from the get-go.
I'm sure we're going to get a Pulitzer Prize.
I'm sure we are,
and
too.
I wouldn't get your hopes up, Bill. As Media Matters has documented, Fox has conducted an 8-month-long campaign to spread misinformation about the terror attack in Benghazi.
For more on this and other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
All right. If you are in Los Angeles today, vote. Today is the mayoral election in Los Angeles. I know I don't live there anymore, but from all I've read, Eric Garcetti is the guy you want to vote for, please. Wendy Gruhl sounds like her name, Gruhl. Not good for L.A. It doesn't taste good either. Eric Garcetti, go out and vote for him. If you want to help the victims of the tornado in Oklahoma, it's just horrific. There's a group called Team Rubicon. Team Rubicon is made up of, I want to find the link here. They are veterans who go and respond to disasters. They will take any money you donate and immediately put it into action. They have people on the ground today. From their website, TeamRubiconUSA.org, it says, they written yesterday, this afternoon finds us devastated as we watch the events outside of Oklahoma City unfold. The tornadoes that ripped through the city of Moore earlier today have left a community devastated, searching desperately for loved ones and hope. Team Rubicon can't pretend to replace what has been lost, but as you read this, we are in the midst of activating every resource at our disposal to help these people in their time of need. Moore, Oklahoma, is a disaster zone of unimaginable chaos, but luckily, chaos is what we do well. By tomorrow, again, this was written yesterday, so by today, Team Rubicon will have initial assessment teams on the ground. Within days, We will have mobilized a full response team, a full response to help the people affected by this devastating disaster. They say we need your help. Please consider supporting us in our response. And then there's a link to fundraise.teamrubiconusa.org. My friend Richard Allen Smith started a fundraiser for them. That's who I donated to this morning. I will post links to all of this on my blog today at RadioOrNot.com. This is a great way to help. I know it's easy to donate to the American Red Cross. They will get millions of dollars in donations. And that's good. But, you know, all the money donated to the Red Cross goes into their general fund, also helps pay exorbitant salaries for their upper echelon administration, and doesn't necessarily get to the ground. What you donate to Team Rubicon will get right there quickly. What else? Okay, tornado, federal worker striking in D.C., Home Defenders League at DOJ, the Sun Sentinel doesn't need a Coke problem, feedtheus.com, and Kim Doyle Murray, call your congressman and tell them no cuts to SNAP. Election Day in Los Angeles and the March Against Monsanto this Saturday. Yes, I will. We'll get into that, as the week continues. I guess I could talk about this hate talker, Santilli. Is it worth it? You know, that would sort of darken the rest of the show. I could talk about the fact that Ray Manzarek died yesterday. Yeah, the keyboard player for The Doors, Ray Manzarek, died yesterday, which is, it's a loss. You know, he was 72, suffered from bile duct cancer. 72, 74, maybe. Hopefully he will, his music will live on, right? I'd rather take the last few minutes to read this from rollcall.com. We'll go out with a Doors song. in honor of Raymond Zarek. But let me read to you this from Roll Call. The tornado damage near Oklahoma City is still being assessed, and the death toll is expected to rise. But already, Senator Tom Coburn, this was from 9:30 last night, by the way, Tom Coburn, Republican, Oklahoma, says he will insist that any federal disaster aid to be paid for with cuts elsewhere. CQ Roll Call reporter Jennifer Schultz wrote for CQ.com Monday evening that Coburn said he would absolutely demand offsets for any federal aid that Congress provides. Coburn added, she wrote, that it is too early to guess at a damage toll, but that he knows for certain he will fight to make sure disaster funding that the federal government contributes is paid for. It's a position he has taken repeatedly during his career when Congress debates emergency funding for disaster aid. Schultes points out that Coburn was one of 36 Republican senators who voted against disaster funding for Superstorm Sandy in January. Tornado or tornadoes that ripped through central Oklahoma have killed at least 51, according to the New York Times. Of the disaster funding issue, there's no telling yet how much FEMA will use to respond to the tornado that hit near Oklahoma City on Monday, but FEMA spent more than $200 million to aid Missouri after the tornado. Remember that, Joplin? Tore through Joplin almost exactly 2 years ago. Schultes writes that, notes that the White House issued a statement Monday evening saying the Federal Emergency Management Agency was monitoring the storm, blah, 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 blah. And apparently the president spoke earlier today and said, we will help. Because that's what we do. We help one another. And if today's show had any message at all, it's that we need to keep helping one another. That's all. Ray Manzarek, rest in peace. It's not over yet. I'll talk to you tomorrow, radio or not. Bye, everyone.